Because Brezhnev would not have called Boney M.
He is very close with Gloria Gaynor, though.
A lot of people don't know about their affair.
That's a romance novel I'm writing. It could be like Gloria to the Soviet Union.
How Brezhnev wanted nothing to do with Gaynor.
Listen, we'll work on it. I'm Charlie Sohn, a screenwriter and journalist.
I'm Agnes Reese, a pop singer and songwriter.
And this is Mysteries of the Euroverse.
On this episode, we're talking about the Intervision Song Contest, Eurovision's equivalent behind the Iron Curtain.
First, we deep dive into the ISC's history and talk about why Putin's attempts to revive the contest fundamentally misunderstand it.
Then we talk to Dean Vuletic, an expert on Intervision, about some of the myths associated with the contest.
Finally, we sit down with Billboard chart expert Chris Molanphy to explore the music of Intervision in a game we're calling Intervision Tops and Bottoms, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the ISC.
Take a look behind the scenes at all the scandal songs and queens. So come along as we traverse all the mysteries of the Euroverse. Euroverse.
We are back for another episode of Mysteries of the Euroverse.
Today, we're talking about something that even Eurovision fans know very little about. The thing is, you can't tell the entire history of Eurovision without including the Intervision Song Contest.
The Intervision Song Contest is the Eurovision equivalent that existed behind the Iron Curtain.
As someone who introduced you to Eurovision, you introduced me to Intervision.
Generally, I get introduced to something and then I find the most Eastern European version of it. Here we are, people. The Intervision Song Contest, it's back in the news because friend of the pod, Vladimir Putin, has been making noises about bringing the Intervision Song Contest back. The thing that excited us the most about doing this episode is that Putin's idea of Intervision is the opposite of what Intervision really was, right? Putin's Intervision is the idea that now Russia has been kicked out of Eurovision. They're going to take their toys and go home.
When we look at the history of the contest, it was not this top-down Soviet-run propaganda machine.
The ISC, until Putin did it in 2008, was never organized by Russia or the Soviet Union. It was really organized in these kind of revolutionary moments when individual republics were liberalizing. First Czechoslovakia, then Poland. Rather than it being this kind of oppositional propaganda outlet, it actually was about cultural diplomacy and connecting to the West. Right? The Intervision Song Contest was much more open than even Eurovision was to acts in general that were on the other side of the Iron Curtain. And a big idea that I'm just going to throw out there for this is this idea that was common among liberalizers in some of these Soviet republics, which is the idea of practicing the politics of as if.
Right. The idea of as if is that people will have maybe an outward politics, and then they will have a closed-door politics that might be the real one. But it's kind of taking someone at their word.
Yes, this is exactly it. You had the Soviet regime that very often were claiming to have things like human rights. And so the idea was, take them at their word, practice the politics of as if, and then eventually, hopefully, the idea is that in that disconnect between the as if and the reality, enough people see the gap that you get progress.
You're like, oh, you just said you're for human rights and all we're doing here is human rights.
Right.
And then you're just like, damn it. Yes. I actually want to shut it down. But if I do,
I look like a hypocrite.
Exactly.
And so that's the way it was typically practiced, protesters, activists toward their government. The ISC is interesting because it does have that. Czechoslovakia during the 60s and Poland during the 70s were both liberalizing. So ISC wasn't oppositional towards those governments.
Right.
But then you have to think of the regime in Moscow. What was interesting about the ISC, though, was that it wasn't only a politics of as if towards, let's say, the repressive Soviet regime. It was a politics of as if towards the entire globe, especially, you know, if we look at the 60s, there was a lot of rhetoric about togetherness, about uniting the world. Eurovision and the EBU were not bringing the world together. They were bringing half of the world together. Yeah. Intervision wanted to unite a divided world.
And you can see this because already in its fourth year of existence, in 1968, they open it wide. And its Eastern and Western countries, non-aligned and non-European nations, were involved as well. We're looking at Spain. We're looking at Cuba. They've gone quite broad, much broader than Eurovision had done at the same time.
Why do we misremember the ISC? It's not just Putin. There are so many articles when you first just Google that have these like very short little like paragraphs about the ISC. And they all kind of make it out to be an Eastern propaganda outlet or some sort of inferior copy.
Generally speaking, the Western world has a certain view of the Eastern Bloc. There was a certain incentive at making the Eastern Bloc look backwards to fit a certain story.
There is another explanation. The goal of Eurovision was to unite Europe. And they were very clear about that from the beginning. A number of places on the website that it says that. Intervision had a more difficult line to walk. You had the individual republic's government and broadcaster, but this was existing against the backdrop of the Soviets. So the ISC could never be too explicit about what it was doing.
To the sort of Soviet powers that be, I think the ISC kind of functioned like the drama club at a school, where it was like, let them play around. And we know that for the school's reputation, it's important that we say we have an arts program. The Intervision Song Contest had three iterations. The first iteration was 1965 to 1968. It comes back in 1977 and lasts until 1980. And then it gets brought back as a one-off in 2008. And that one is a little bit of an outlier.
For reasons that you may have already guessed. So we are moving into Czechoslovakia in 1965, where you get the first version of the ISC. Now, the ISC was organized by OIRT, the Eastern Bloc version of the EBU. Now, to talk about the backdrop against which this contest was starting, broadly, the Soviet Union was in a period of de-Stalinization, right? And there were these goals of both introducing more individual freedom, but also a different orientation toward the West. The Intervision Song Contest played into both of these things, right? To the point where OIRT was talking to the EBU constantly.
So much so were they working together that the OIRT suggested that they do a song competition together. The EBU turned that down. After this was suggested, Intervision Song Contest is launched. At the same time, the EBU is sharing the broadcast of Eurovision with OIRT. So they're seeing both.
If Intervision was meant to compete with Eurovision, it would not make sense that OIRT would at the same time start airing Eurovision in the Eastern Bloc.
Right.
The ISC was hosted in Czechoslovakia. The first contest was hosted in Prague. Prague was always a bit of a cultural mecca. Under Stalin, it really suffered and actually was fairly slow in terms of the de-Stalinization process, right? But by the 60s, you had the Czech New Wave going on. Music, film, everything was very cutting edge. So it was the perfect place to host this festival.
Yes, it's in Czechoslovakia, but yes, there's also the Soviets. The presenter, Jacek Bromski, is what he said to BBC in 2012.
I love this.
Of course, I know the rules. I couldn't say I hate Stalin, Lenin, and the rest of you communist pigs, because they would probably put me in jail. But it didn't prevent me from saying something between the lines, because that gave you a lot of applause from the public.
Like, everybody knew what was going on, right? There was this one organizer, Eugenius Terlicky. He was talking about how sometimes artists from the Soviet Union representing the Russians, essentially, would get whistled at and booed, not because of the artists. At the ISC, audiences found a way that they could express their dissatisfaction without provoking a response. However, 1968 really, they started to push things, right? Eurovision, if you win, you get to host the contest. The ISC didn't work that way. It stayed with Czechoslovakia, but they were able to move the contest year to year, first to Bratislava as sort of a nod to the Slovaks, and then eventually to this resort town in 1968 that was chosen because it was near the border of East and West.
They're inviting countries from all over the world. They're putting it close to the border. Like, there becomes a question of how implicit can you be before it's going to be interpreted as explicit?
This is going alongside a lot that's going on in Czechoslovakia in 1968. You had Alexander Dubček, who basically was bringing the country into a much more liberalized, a much more free place. Amidst protest, amidst all kinds of chaos, Soviet tanks roll into Czechoslovakia in 1968 and basically undo all the liberalization, all the reforms. And with that, the ISC is stopped. These politics of as if, when they became too explicit, they can be crushed, right? So the keeping things implicit, the sort of wink, wink, nudge, nudge of Intervision was really necessary in a way.
Drama club got too much power.
In your metaphor in life, the drama club never has too much power. The other side of that is that a lot of historians now look at the Prague Spring, this moment of liberal revolution that then gets crushed, and they draw a straight line to the Velvet Revolution when the Czechs finally throw off the shackles of the Soviet Union and move to become an independent nation. So the line between as if and reality might happen on a long timeline, but the ISC is part of a movement that really took a big step forward. It's an interesting thing about OIRT and Intervision being more open is that you get these countries that are both non-aligned countries, even Western European countries. In a way, they give us a lens on the outsider view of the Eastern Bloc. What's great about looking at a country like Finland and their broadcaster, YLE, is they were a country that had one foot in Western Europe and one foot on the other side of the Iron Curtain.
That's always kind of been a little bit where Finland's at. It has Norway and Sweden on one side, and then it has Russia on the other. Culturally, there are many things that are similar to the Nordic countries, but then their language is of the same family as Russian.
A lot of this information, just so you know, is from Marie Payala, who's an academic, her paper, Intervision Song Contest and Finnish Television Between East and West. It gives you a real sense at the time of how Finnish journalists, how Finnish people, and how the Finnish public broadcaster looked at both Eurovision and the ISC at this point in the mid-60s to sort of situate us. Right? The Soviet Union is undergoing de-Stalinization. It's looking like they've come up with this great balance of the sort of high-mindedness of international socialism, but with the civil rights and the human rights and the civil liberties that Western nations promised.
Wiley had committed to having more culturally enriching programming, and they felt like they were going to get that more from the ISC.
So you had Aaron Wally, who was a reporter for Wiley, who was pushing for Finland to leave Eurovision. A, it's more open, right? B, the jury system makes more sense because the way the ISC worked is there was one jury, not a ton of national juries. And then also there was all of this background stuff, right?
At this point, the Soviet Union looks strong.
So to really put a fine point on it, this idea of Western perception of the ISC, Carol Gott won the ISC in 1968 with the song Where the Wind Goes to Sleep. It was seen very much as an implicit criticism of the divide between East and West. So much so that after the Prague Spring, Austria actually invited Carol Gott to represent them at Eurovision.
If someone went to the ISC to find their entrant for Eurovision,
clearly the quality,
they're not looking down on it. Almost a decade later, in 1977, we now have the ISC 2.0.
Just to give you a little bit of background on what was going on in Poland in the time, you had this guy, Edward Gierek, and he was, again, a liberalizing force. He was pursuing both economic liberalization and things like loosening censorship. The market reforms seemed to create an economic miracle in the mid-70s. One thing that's going to come into play later is he was borrowing a lot from foreign countries to make this economic miracle happen. So the ISC moves to Poland.
We saw in ISC 1.0 that it moved towards more and more global expansion, not us versus them.
Yeah.
And we see it again with Poland. One of those ways is that they're not shying away from Western acts, as you always would do if you want to show that you are open. You call Gloria Gaynor.
I mean, I've called her many times. No response. But I'm not Poland. The fact that Boney M played the ISC.
Ra, ra, Rasputin.
All the kids love it again for some reason.
Once we move towards ISC 2.0, the Finnish viewpoint changes. This is where we get back to the important thing about the foundation of Eurovision, the technical marvel.
Eurovision's technological innovation was in the service of its cultural diplomacy, right?
So when that technical aspect starts to at least fall far behind, you start to see them in comparison in a different light.
There was a fair amount of xenophobia and stereotyping, like, oh, those Eastern Europeans, they're just so backwards. Their cars break down all the time.
Right, they can't even transmit from Poland to Finland.
Right, exactly.
Gosh.
Exactly. So it's like the broadcasts that made it to Finland were riddled with technical issues. And where along the process that happened is actually not important, because the thing that we're talking about is what the perception was.
Right.
Finland won the ISC in 1980. They didn't even live broadcast Marian Rung's win. Like, they took like an hour-long package of the entire multi-day festival. Finns would get really disappointed and angry if they did anything less but win the ISC, because they had started to think of themselves as so superior. There was one year where they placed fifth and they were like out of their minds furious.
And then the most technological advanced thing they did was they voted via light switches.
Well, and this
or
is...
Or did they?
Right, exactly. To explain this, the kind of rumors that get stuck in people's head about the ISC include that people voted for their favorite act by turning on and off their lights, and the idea was that the electric company would, I guess, track the differences in power usage when a certain act was on the television. If you think about it for 2 seconds, is like so dumb. But like the reason a lot of smart people can believe something so dumb is that they actually think that people in Eastern Europe are essentially living in a cave. It's not even like Eurovision was doing a televote in 77 to 80. So why people thought they needed to come up with some insane reason why people were voting via light switch?
If they did vote via light switches, they were ahead of their time.
Yeah.
They figured out how to do a televote before the telesystem was there, basically.
I was
go off, girl. ISC 2.0 comes to an end. And it was not because it was really hard to run a television song contest from caves.
Yeah, the lighting grid went down.
Yeah.
Garrick's market reforms that we talked about earlier actually started failing, right?
Right, because the bill had to be paid.
The bill had to be paid. He was borrowing a lot of money, and this is one of the problems with capitalism.
The dock workers were striking, and financially the country is struggling.
Right.
And then they go, hey, see this lavish festival thoughts?
But what about the music? The eyes of the world are watching. And so these protests are going on while the festival is happening. And it exposed the world to these protests.
Jerzy Gruza, the Polish director of the Intervision Song Contest, said, and I quote, "I remember there was a big bang up on stage. A lamp had broken. 2 minutes later, the entire orchestra was sitting in the bus trying to escape. They thought it was a bomb. United by music."
If you look at some of our contemporaneous Finnish reports, people were focused on the protest. People were reporting the controversy. So for reasons of economics, for the conflict and later martial law that was enacted in Sopot, the ISC 2.0 ended. But again, we are talking about a moment where all of this change almost went too far. Therefore, Intervision and the changes happening around it needed to be stopped. The criticism is never, oh, wow, they shouldn't have gone that far in 68. Oh, wow, these liberalizing reforms didn't work out, although he probably shouldn't have borrowed so much money. But again, when you think of the perspective that these organizers had in both Czechoslovakia and Poland, they planted the seed that led them to victory. This is all to say that the politics of Azef, you push it too far, you're going to get a repressive reaction. But that doesn't mean that this two steps forward, one step back thing isn't worth it in the end.
Right, because the point is that the issue isn't the as if, the issue is the isn't. It's what stands in the opposition to as if. That's the issue.
Yeah, I have to say, sometimes I do practice the politics of isn't. It's not great.
So ISC ends in 1980. The person who brings it back is Putin, and he brings it back in 2008. At this point, Putin is frustrated. Russia has put more money into trying to win Eurovision than probably any other nation, and they are just not winning.
The irony is that Russia actually wins Eurovision that year, and then we get no other Intervision Song Contest from Russia. To do a sort of Magnusy metaphor on this, it's really like not getting invited to your college rager, joining AA, receiving a last-minute text that you're allowed to be there, and then going and getting plaster.
I like that. It is really fascinating to see how these world leaders can be like, oh, my own song contest.
Putin attending Eurovision rehearsals when Russia hosted.
This is not where Biden comes on Sesame Street and does a thing. You know what I mean?
No, yeah, yeah.
This is like Putin coming to oversee that this music competition is run properly so Russia looks good.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's, you know, like, it's truly insane. And actually, I think the craziest thing about it was his spontaneous cover of Euphoria. And I will say, addressing Ukraine with the lyric "Together till the end of time."
Oh my God.
Just
ruined the song.
The ISC, for its message to really resonate, part of the problem really was that they weren't allowed to articulate it. Now, what I kept thinking is Eurovision is allowed to articulate whatever it wants. Soviets aren't waiting with tanks to roll in on Martin Osterdahl's office. And, you know, the other big lesson that I kept thinking about is the way that we narrativize things as conflict. You see this with the US and China now. Anthony Blinken keeps talking about a great power competition. Xi Jinping is not a great leader.
Controversial statement.
Controversial statement. But it's a very big, powerful country. Things like global warming, things like international trade in general, they are a country that we need to work with. If the narrative that we absorb from last time the world felt like it was coming apart was that what it took was aggression and strength and closing yourself off until your quote-unquote enemy crumples, if that's our general principle moving forward, I think I'm a lot less excited about the world, even though I criticize the EBU and Eurovision. This other side of it is the thing that I think that Eurovision gets right, which is that fundamentally, as naive as it can seem sometimes to be like, yeah, we're united by music, we're all together, I think it's much closer to the way that the world actually works.
I think in many ways, the argument is that their staying power is not rooted in their implicit, which maybe is what their self-conception is. Their staying power is actually in the explicit.
In their values. That's brilliant. I mean, I'm shocked. I was not expecting that at all. No, with that, I think we should get to our guests. So first, we have the incredible Dean Vuletic. He's an expert on Eurovision. He's an expert on the ISC, and he is a historian who specializes in Eastern Europe. So he's really the perfect person to talk to.
Then we speak with Chris Molanphy, who is truly an expert on all things music, and is certainly an expert if you're talking about the Billboard Hot 100, the American music chart. You could literally list a random date to him, and he could tell you what was charting at the time.
Yes, I am so excited that we have Chris on this episode. He hosts basically my favorite music podcast, next to Mysteries of the Euroverse, of course. He hosts the podcast Hit Parade for Slate. The depth of this man's knowledge is incredible.
And because of that depth of knowledge, the only way we could really challenge the man was we gave him a game with songs that he would be as far removed from as humanly possible, which is why he is our American guest for the ISC episode.
The game is called Intervision Tops and Bottoms, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the ISC.
Yes. Before we get to that, let's throw it over to our interview with Dean. How did you find out about the ISC and what drew you to studying it initially?
Well, I came across the Intervision Song Contest when I started doing my research on the Eurovision Song Contest. I'm actually trained as a historian of Eastern Europe, and for my PhD, I wrote about popular music and politics in Yugoslavia. Yugoslavia was the only Eastern European country that participated in Eurovision during the Cold War. And in doing my research on that, I came across the Intervision Song Contest and thought that this would be an excellent research topic as well. There are so many myths about Intervision that I really felt it was my duty as a historian to find out the truth. First of all, this was not a Soviet-led initiative. Probably the most important myth that I challenge in my research. This was an initiative led, first of all, by the Czechoslovaks and their television station, and then by the Poles in the late 1970s. And it really reflected the openness and the liberalization that was being undertaken by the communist parties in these countries in these periods. The Soviets, the Russians, they actually weren't that interested in Intervision.
We are familiar with the structure of the EBU. OIRT is the Association of Broadcasters that was the Eastern Bloc Association. So what was the involvement of the Soviet Union in OIRT? And how much was that actually just a federation of all of the individual states' broadcasters? And how much of it had an element of Soviet control to it?
Well, of course, the Soviets were the dominant voice in the OIRT, the biggest country, the leader of the communist world, the biggest producer of radio and television programs as well. However, the OIRT was based in Prague because of Czechoslovakia's central position in the western part of Eastern Europe. It was geographically, geopolitically, the right place to put the headquarters. Also because Czechoslovakia, the Czech side especially, was the most technologically advanced part of the region. And when it comes to the actual Intervision network, which was established for television co-productions, the initial members were actually East Germany, Hungary, Czechoslovakia, and Poland, not the Soviet Union. Because remember, at this time, there weren't satellites. So to connect countries, you needed to have terrestrial connections. And at that time, the Soviet Union was still too far away to connect. So if you think about the expansion of Eurovision, you know, it started off in this core, let's say, centered around Switzerland, and then it expands. The key is, remember, this is a terrestrial network. So things have to connect by land, not by sky.
Starting in 1965, can you talk a bit about how the ISC related to a broader project of de-Stalinization?
So after the death of Stalin in 1953, Eastern Europe becomes more open to cooperation with the West. We also see Eastern Europe become more culturally liberal. And actually, the pioneer of all of this is Yugoslavia, which leaves the Eastern Bloc already in 1948. It's opposed to domination by the Soviet Union, domination by Stalin. It even joins the EBU as a founding member, and it debuts in Eurovision in 1961 and is the only Eastern European country that's allowed to participate in Eurovision during the Cold War as a result. So the Eastern European countries that were allied with the Soviet Union, none of them were allowed to participate in Eurovision.
Can you talk a little bit about Albania and what their relationship was both to de-Stalinization and therefore what their relationship was to the ISC?
I mentioned Yugoslavia as an exception, and Albania was also an exception, but to the other extreme. Albania wanted to stay loyal to a Stalinist line. It left the Eastern European organizations, including the OIRT, which meant that it never participated in Intervision, let alone Eurovision. Nonetheless, it did have its own national pop song festival called very simply the Song Festival. And these days, that's where Albanians select their entry for Eurovision. Albanians did watch Eurovision during the Cold War, though subversively. They would watch it through Greek or Italian broadcasts.
OIRT had a suggestion to do a joint contest. Can you talk about that?
Yes, that happened in 1964, and the head of Czechoslovak television, Jiří Pelikán, proposed this to the EBU then, and the EBU rejected the idea. They weren't convinced that Eurovision should be continued. There were discussions on this every year until the late 1970s, whether the format was good, whether it was popular enough, whether it cost too much. Young people watching, the music was often criticized for not being modern enough. And actually, this is something that Eurovision and Intervision share in common, especially in the 1960s. I found that there was a lot of concern in Eurovision that the songs weren't fashionable. And in Intervision, I also found that there was criticism within Czechoslovak television that the entries were too much of these ballads, chansons, and they really wanted things, you know, to become livelier, faster. Both Eurovision and Intervision were, we could say, in the 1960s, behind the trends. But Prague was really experiencing a renaissance in the early 1960s. This was also seen, for example, in the establishment of a jazz festival in Prague in 1964, as well as the Golden Prague Television Festival in the same year. And it was through the Golden Prague Television Festival that Czechoslovak television also launched Intervision.
One big difference between Eurovision and the ISC is that the ISC is not hosted by the winning country. So hosting decisions became much more of a choice and carried real significance. So while 1965 was in Prague that we just talked about, it then moved in 66 and 67 and then again in 68. Can you talk about where and what the significance was?
In 1966 and 1967, things changed because the Slovaks always felt that they were in the shadow of the Czechs. This is why it was decided in 1966 and 1967 that Intervision should be staged in Bratislava. From January 1968, you have this very liberal leadership of the Czechoslovak Communist Party. It's actually led by Alexander Dubček, who is a Slovak, and he institutes these liberalizing reforms, which make Czechoslovakia the most open and liberal part of the Eastern Bloc. Czechoslovak television ends up moving Intervision to Karlovy Vary, a resort town which is very symbolically located near the border with West Germany. In 1968, Intervision opens up to include participation by Western European countries. This includes West Germany, Austria, Belgium, Switzerland, Spain, Finland, and Yugoslavia are also there. Finland is very special because it's the only member of both the Intervision and Eurovision networks. So Intervision takes on a very special meaning in 1968. It becomes the first time that a pan-European song contest is staged in Europe, including countries from both East and West. With the quashing of the Prague Spring in 1968, pop singers had to decide what their choices were, what they were prepared to sacrifice. The leadership of Czechoslovak television was removed. We saw the liberalizing figures being purged. Jiří Pelikán was among them, and he actually went into exile afterwards in Italy. And he stood for the first European Parliament elections in 1979, and he won a seat then, exactly, representing Italy. So I think here the most interesting story is that of Marta Kubišová, who sang with the famous Czech singer Helena Vondráčková in Intervision, and in late 1968, they went on to form the group The Golden Kids. The problem was that Marta Kubišová sang a song called A Prayer for Marta. And in 1970, because of this, she was censored and not allowed to perform in public anymore. Helena Vondráčková, on the other hand, became a key popular music export of Czechoslovakia because she didn't criticize the regime. She She had a big career in the West, especially in West Germany, just like Karel Gott did. And together with Karel Gott, she signed this anti-chart document in 1977, which criticized dissidents who had rallied behind the Charter 77 cause. Helena Vondráčková was the artist who represented Czechoslovakia in this first revival of Intervision, because she was on the side of the government.
Can you talk about the Helsinki Accords and how those became the backdrop and inspiration for the ISC in Poland?
So the Helsinki Accords, signed in 1975, basically every European state is a signatory. They have agreements on human rights, on cultural cooperation, and they also recognize the borders between European states as they are. It's in this context that Polish television decides to revive the idea of Intervision. It takes place in Sopot from 1977 to 1980. And the aim of Polish television then is to include participants even from farther afield. We even have Cuba participating, for example, or Japan. You have a parallel competition occurring in Intervision in Poland for record companies. So you have this very commercial dimension as well. And that's really interesting because in the late 1970s, there was this debate going on in Eurovision regarding the influence of record companies on the contest, especially record companies from bigger countries like the UK and West Germany. And it was especially the Nordic countries that were complaining about this influence of commercial record companies. Because remember, these are public service broadcasters, not commercial private broadcasters. So to have the influence of commercial companies is something that can be quite controversial, especially in the Nordic countries, which have this socialist democratic ethos at this time. So it's very interesting then that the Communist Song Contest is actually more brazenly commercial at this time than the capitalist one.
Can you talk about the Western acts being sent to the ISC?
I think the most interesting anecdote is that of Boney M., which appeared in Sopot in 1979. They sang the song Rasputin, which was censored in the Soviet Union because it was about this spiritual advisor to the Russian Tsarist family that was deposed by the communists, a way for the Poles to highlight their autonomy from the Soviet Union. So we have the liberalizing reforms in Poland setting the scene for the revival of Intervision in 1977, the staging of this quite lavish song contest, which, you know, promotes Poland as a modern, prosperous, and open part of the Eastern Bloc. But there are also economic challenges that the Poles are facing at the time, and these come to a head in 1980 when 1 week before the staging of Intervision in Sopot, there is a strike that begins in the Lenin shipyards. There are protests happening across Poland at this time, so this is not an isolated event, but it's a very important event because a week after Intervision happens in Sopot, at this time, the solidarity movement is established, and that really challenges the authority of the communist government in Poland, so much so that martial law is introduced in Poland in 1981 as a way to suppress these strikes.
And we get to 2008, and this time Russia is the one who hosts the ISC.
It's funny that the Russians thought that they were reviving Intervision when they restaged it in Sochi in 2008. This wasn't a revival because when you think about what we've been talking about in this episode, this was something that was led during the Cold War by the Czechoslovaks, by the Poles. It was an idea about bringing East and West together. It was not an idea of competing with the West, of competing with Eurovision. I think this was an attempt by the Russians to challenge Eurovision, especially after they invested so much money into their entries. But then, of course, in 2008, they did eventually manage to win Eurovision, and they staged it in Moscow in 2009, which was until then the most expensive and extravagant Eurovision ever staged. And that just went to show how important Eurovision was for Putin's Russia to promote itself on the international stage.
Putin's been making noises about a 2024 revival of his revival of the ISC.
This is not the first time there have been so-called plans for this. When Conchita Wurst won Eurovision in 2014, then we heard calls from Russian politicians for Intervision to be revived, as well as a response, let's say, to the pro-gay politics of Eurovision.
This has been really, really great. Dean, thank you so much for joining us. This has been really, really amazing.
No, it's really been a pleasure, and I hope you enjoy This Is Eurovision in Malmö.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, yeah. We'll be there. So.
Oh, great, great. Yeah, then let me know.
Yeah, yeah.
It would be awesome. Great to see you live.
Euroverse.
In Western Europe, the Intervision Song Contest is often thought of as a lesser copy of Eurovision, more often socialist propaganda than real art.
This is a theory we're going to test in a game we're calling Intervision Tops and Bottoms, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the ISC. We have the amazing Chris Molanphy joining us.
Wow, you invited the amazing Chris Molanphy. Too bad the regular Chris Molanphy showed up. Hi, guys.
Chris is the host of the Slate podcast, Hit Parade, which features deep dives into major pop artists viewed through the story told by the Billboard Hot 100. Chris has also written Old Town Road, a book about Lil Nas X's hit, and the elements of American culture that contributed to its dominance of the charts. So, Chris, what do you know about Eurovision coming into this conversation? And because we're talking about Intervision on this episode, have you heard of it at all?
I'll answer the last question first. I had never heard of Intervision, so I am coming into that totally cold. You're already educating me about something very inside baseball, which, speaking as a chart nerd, I appreciate. I started to learn what Eurovision even was in the 1990s. When I was avidly reading Billboard magazine, and Fred Bronson, who was their chart beat columnist in the 90s and aughts, was a huge Eurovision fan. And he was bringing up Eurovision history in his chart beat column. So for example, when Gina G's Ooh Ah Just a Little Bit actually became an American hit in, I believe it was 97 or 98, he was talking about its Eurovision provenance. And that's when I started to kind of dig in, like, what the heck is this thing? And since you brought it up in a previous episode, I'll just say that I found the Netflix movie incredibly charming and got a huge kick out of it. I did enjoy it when Arcade was a hit a couple years ago. It actually crossed over, and that's a lovely song. And just the fact that a Eurovision song was hitting like that. And the fact that Måneskin's entire career in America started not with Zite Boni, a song I love, by the way, but rather their covers, that weird sort of bank shot from Eurovision was interesting as well.
Måneskin still had to give you the English language cover and then hopefully introduce you to Italian language music and get you comfortable with that.
But also, I think what's funny with Måneskin is they mostly recorded in English before Eurovision, and the Italian competition to qualify for Eurovision, there it's a lot more frowned upon to do it in English. It was almost the other way around. That they panned
it's a little backwards for them.
Yeah.
That's funny. I was not fully aware of that, but that's great.
That is the thing you get a lot with Eurovision, right? It's mostly pop artists these days. And then also the sort of like history and self-conception as a cultural festival.
I wound up taking a trip to Sweden the year right after Lordi. I talked to several Swedes who were still sort of chuffed that a Scandinavian act had won Eurovision, and with a hard rock song nonetheless. To your point about how mostly it's straight up pop. It was so charming when a rock song won Eurovision like that.
When a song like that wins, it changes the contest forever. Would Måneskin have even competed if something like that hadn't happened?
So Chris, we're going to play you a song that was featured in the Intervision Song Contest, or ISC. And we're going to tell you the year it was performed as well. The idea of this game is using your knowledge of Western pop trends. We want you to guess if this song placed in the top half of the ISC that year or in the bottom. We're hoping this leads to a conversation about what differences, if any, there were between the music being celebrated behind the Iron Curtain and what was popular in the West at these two distinct moments in Soviet history and then more recently in Putin's Russia.
So all of these songs are Russian in some way or Eastern European?
One of the big differences between the Intervision Song Contest and Eurovision is Intervision was much more open than Eurovision's. In 1968, they opened it up to even Western European countries. So Franco's Spain actually competed in the 1968 one. And I believe also West Germany competed in 1968.
So Intervision was trying to do its own uniting at one time.
In a way, it was kind of more open to uniting across the Iron Curtain than Eurovision was at the time.
As I was saying to you guys before we went on camera, I appreciate that you're picking something that I know even less about. Thus, I am not obligated to have any expertise in this whatsoever.
What we try to do on this podcast is lower the bar as much as possible.
Love so, let's get that sucker down to the floor.
Yes. So first up, we have Czech singer Karel Gott, who at the 1965 Intervision Song Contest performed the song Where the Wind Goes to Sleep.
It's like he's got the look of a Bobby Vinton or an Andy Williams crossed with the voice of Tom Jones. He really is letting loose like Tom Jones on, I don't know, What's New Pussycat or Thunderball or something like that. But about yeah. It's basically pop as defined pre-rock and especially pre-Beatles. Like it's 65, yes. But this could have been performed in 1961 and 1955. But I do mean what I say in the analogy to Tom Jones in the sense that it's a big brassy voice that is in its way kind of 60s.
It's got more energy to it than your sort of classic crooner or something like that.
You right, know? This is not a Perry Como voice. It's a post-rock voice with no rock in it, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
The Eastern Bloc wasn't as far behind as the West would like to say they were.
If they were behind, they were behind by maybe 3 years.
When we get down to those kind of distinctions, there is this complication where it's like Eurovision is often a step or two behind the charts. And particularly at this inflection point, right? What Chris, you're talking about, like the advent of rock, and then you have a contest where the requirement is you have a giant orchestra on stage.
I'm going to go counterintuitive. As impressive as this performance is, I wonder if this was too, quote, innovative for Intervision in 1965 and maybe it placed in the bottom half. That's my guess.
I really appreciate the classic Slate pitch, as they used to say. The hot take there. But no, so Karel Gott won that year.
Oh, he won. Deservedly. Yes. It's a good song.
Yeah, and he's a great performer. And actually, it was such a big hit that Austria, which was obviously in Eurovision, had him represent their country in Eurovision 3 years later. Oh. Look at Karel Gott uniting rock and crooner music, uniting East and West.
I'm being political in 1965, which actually puts him slightly ahead of the curve because most of the protest music in the States was 66, 67, 68.
You're almost ready for the political comment when you hear some electric guitars start. But in a ballad like that,
it reminds me a little bit of the performance of Edelweiss at the end of The Sound of Music, where merely by performing an Austrian folk song, the Von Trapps are in a way doing a quiet form of protest in front of the Nazis.
Moving on from Edelweiss, from Karel Gott, our next song is by Kati Kovacs, who represented Hungary with her song Elegy in 1977. So this is the second version of the ISC.
She's like the unknown fifth member of ABBA. Wrong language.
It's like when you learn there's another Jonas brother.
The bonus Jonas. It's like the bonus ABBA member. She's got the right haircut for it, at the very least. Well, the arrangement, it's got bits of Fernando in it. It's got a bit of Knowing Me, Knowing You. It sounds like 1977, and I mean that as neutrally as possible, neither as an endorsement or a denigration. It just kind of is. It's very 1977.
Yes. The judges of the ISC, did they like this very 1977 song in 1977?
I'll just go for broke and say, sure, they liked it.
So they did not at the ISC, but this is very confusing because Kati Kovacs was a huge star in Hungary at the time and definitely thought of as a kind of pop diva. One of Kati Kovacs' songs was actually sampled in Christina Aguilera's 2010 single Woohoo, which is the Nicki Minaj track. You know you really wanna hurt, wanna taste my, you know
Oh, wow. Which wasn't a big hit, but it's a thing that existed that I half forgot existed. Right.
And the reason it wasn't a big success was because of the juries of the ISC. Now, for the next one, we're not going to move very far because we're staying in 1977. And we have Farah Maria's El Recuerdo de Aquel Largo Viaje.
So, Chris, this is an entry from Cuba.
And I have a built-in bias toward this because folks don't know this, given my Irish last name, but I am actually Cuban on my dad's side.
This is not taken from her Intervision performance. This is her performing years later. But the same song.
It's a really sturdy melody. It stuck to my brain almost instantly. I'm looking at a later performance, but it seems like a song, as long as you've got the voice for it, you can't screw up too much. I have to imagine this was well received, but you'll tell me.
You are 100% right. Yes.
Okay.
The song came in third place.
Yes, the song is sung in Spanish, but frankly, it could be a Eurovision song. There's nothing about it that actually screams out Cuban to me. It's not salsa merengue adjacent. It doesn't have a piano motuño or any of the hallmarks of what you would consider Cuban or Caribbean music. And I'm not sure that's an insult. It's adaptable in that way.
I think this probably does connect to the mission of the ISC, which was about, I think, projecting a sort of Western-friendly image a little bit, you know, bringing Western stars, like trying to be collaborative with Eurovision. Now that we can have like national finals and televotes and stuff like that, and people can select songs that represent their country, I think there probably is more of a desire to be like, I want you to hear what my like country's music is like.
Right.
Whereas if you're literally in the prime minister's office being like, who's the artist that we're going to send to like communicate what we want to communicate this year, sticking with 1977, we are going to move on to a Polish group, Czerwon Gittery.
Wow. That's some combination. The look is Gibb Brothers, peak Bee Gees, or Yacht Rock, circa Player, or something like that. But that's not the sound at all. The sound is schlager. It's almost got an oompa. And yet, they're kind of dressing it up. This dude's playing a double-necked guitar. There's a heavy bass line, but the heavy bass line is just thump, thump. I mean, it could just as easily be being played by a tuba.
Right.
And it's catchy for what it is, but it's trying to look hip, but the music itself is not hip. I'll just guess that the costumes put them over the top somehow. Maybe it was the cute boy factor or something. They do have great hair.
Yeah.
So I'll guess that it hit.
I think the juries went wild for the hair. They placed second, which was like above Farah Maria, which my mind was blown by that.
Because the Farah Maria song is a better song.
Yes,
just
absolutely.
To come right out and say it.
There are a lot of articles about them that refer to them as the Polish Beatles. Also, the height of their popularity seems to be more late 60s, early 70s. And this Intervision competition, it's like sending Bonnie Tyler to Eurovision, where you're like,
oh, yeah,
a little late for that. Then thinking about like Poland at the time, there was like a real liberalization that happened very, very quickly in Poland. So I wonder if this band, listeners, chime in. But it feels to me like this may have been like one foot in what was going on in Polish culture 10 years before this performance. And maybe this was kind of a celebration, a send-off of sorts. That's what I would like to believe anyway.
A little farewell.
Kind of what the Tragically Hip were to Canada when they did their farewell concert 5 or 6 years ago. The Tragically Hip were a legendary band in Canada, and their leader developed a form of brain cancer. And he was well enough for one last concert that was not only sold out in a stadium, but broadcast on Canadian television. And it was like all of Canada bid collective farewell to this beloved group all at once, knowing that the guy was about to die.
Now we're going to move to 1980. And we've got Marion Rung with Where Is the Love?
Just to clarify, this was not the basis for the Black Eyed Peas song.
Where is the love? Where is the love? Where is the love?
Singing in English. It's a sturdy melody. I find the song a little corny, but you hear that chorus 1.5 times and you know it immediately. It's a song that is not subtle, especially when that truck gear shift key change.
Yeah.
It's kind of like, you thought it was dramatic, brother? Well, check this out. Clunk. I can't tell if Where Is the Love is somehow a coded political message.
There's a story about Andrew Lloyd Webber sending Hal Prince cats. And Hal Prince goes, so it's based on this T.S. Eliot poem. And here are a list of the references that I found. Is this like a political allegory? And Andrew Lloyd Webber just goes, Hal, it's about cats. And Hal Prince says, that's the last time we ever spoke about that show. Like, that is a little bit where the love is.
It means what it looks like.
It means what it says. Yeah.
So I don't know. I'll say it underperformed just to make things interesting.
She actually won the competition.
Holy cow.
She had represented Finland in Eurovision in 1973. So it's another Euroverse, multiverse crossover here.
It was possible for all these countries to play both sides of the fence and do both Eurovision and Intervision in any given year.
Actually, Eurovision really limited the people who could participate.
And the ISC had participants that were not part of
the IRT, which was
the equivalent. One way, but not the other. They were much more exclusive on the Eurovision side.
There's this stereotype about the Soviets being very closed off. And I don't know if you've heard that Patrick Radenkief podcast about the Winds of Change. It's like literally the CIA was doing these sort of cultural propaganda things. And it's amazing that the Eastern Bloc was like, yes, please. Like, send us your Western artists. Give us Gloria Gaynor. Give us Boney M. on the stage.
It's a commentary on soft power. Rock and roll and pop is largely controlled by the Americans and by the Western Europeans. And so you aspire to that sound, even if pride of the Soviets would preclude that in political circles. When it comes to cultural products, they're going to aspire to that because they want to say, oh no, we can do this just as well as the Westerners can.
Yes, exactly. And this transitions us to our final video. There is something in the fact that the ISC was not organized by the Soviet Union. Essentially, it was like these semi-liberalizing pockets finding permission to go slightly off script. So in 2008, and now these days, he's claiming that he's going to do it again, Putin decided to revive the ISC.
Fair.
So from the 2008 ISC, Tamina Niyazova, who represented Tajikistan with the song Zangi Telephone.
It was going into what sounded almost like some flamenco guitar, which is apropos because the whole thing sounds remarkably Latin. It sounds like a florid Latin ballad, not salsa or reggaeton, certainly, but very Latin flavor. You could picture the Luis Fonsi of 20 years ago singing this, or even, this is a stretch, but Selena a decade earlier. I suppose we're now about 10 years after the explosion of Anglophilic Latin pop. I'll just throw caution to the wind and say that it was a big hit.
It won.
It won.
It's a really strong song. She's really great. I found it very striking that Putin's Russia would be celebrating an ethnically Tajik singer. And also at the same time, Dima Bilan's Believe, which Russia won Eurovision with that same year, was produced by Timbaland. I don't know if it was about the audience being different, the juries being different, tastes being different, but the contrast between the sort of like Russian song that had won that exact same year and then this Russian hosted contest celebrating a kind of music that felt like a different time was like kind of surprising to me.
Well, so my point about the fact that it's now a decade past the Latin pop explosion of the turn of the millennium, 2008 is about a decade and a half past the fall of the Soviet Union. And this is the period when George W. Bush and then soon Barack Obama are engaging with Putin. So like, this is about as engaged with the West as culture in Russia is going to be. So in a way, something Latin derived like this, you can see it working for
money. You're right, because we are 4 years after Tattoo, right? It's this sort of idea of Putin's Russia as this very capitalist, very up with the global trends kind of environment.
And correct me if I'm wrong, Tattoo was produced by that most capitalist of British producers, Trevor Horn, owner of A Lonely Heart fame, of Buggles, Video Killed the Radio Star fame, Like that guy really? will go anywhere to make a hit. And I say this with admiration. It's just the most crass of British producers. It's like, what do I have to take to turn this into a hit? The more I learn about Eurovision, the more I'm impressed with its breadth and its borderlessness. And it impresses me that this alternate competition, Intervision, it really defies stereotype at every turn. None of what you played me, with maybe the exception of the first clip from 65, is trying to sound terribly American. And the kind of potpourri nature of it is what impresses me. It is charming how, you know, unpredictable the competition is and how it reflects political currents at the time, and yet it kind of rides above them at the same time.
Entirely unpredictable and charming is the perfect way to put a nice bow on it. I just want to say thank you so much, Chris, for taking the time to be with us.
Yeah, seriously, this has been amazing. Euroverse.
I mean, I thought that was a great episode, no matter what side of the Iron Curtain you're on.
Yeah, I liked it so much, I might get iron curtains for my bedroom.
Oh, that would work so well. Yeah. It would match your shirt.
But next week, something that has kind of become the predominant news coverage, certainly in America, when it comes to Eurovision.
Yes.
And it has to do with Israel's participation.
Yes. So we are going to cover Israel's participation in Eurovision, as well as generally how the EBU makes decisions as to whether or not a country stays in the coalition, gets into Eurovision for a particular year. And that has to do both with the country's actions, the actions of the broadcaster, and also the song submitted.
It's an episode that is about what choices do we both think the EBU will make based on the history of what the contest has done so far.
So it's a big episode. We're very excited for it. We hope you check your feed with anticipation on Wednesday.
And until then,
happy Eurovision.